First at 4, thunderstorms could be popping over southeast Michigan, and if they show up, they're going to get strong. We'll show you how many we're expecting and also where temperatures go for the weekend. Karen.
All right, Ben, also first at 4, a father's anguish. Detroit police are investigating a home invasion that left a 12-year-old boy badly traumatized. Paula.
Three little boys separated by a travel ban on opposite sides of the world.
Didn't make the plane go back.
Today, lawmakers announced how they are banding together to ban the ban.
Are we going to let hate and fear divide this country?
It's a civics class on what it takes to reverse a Supreme Court ruling, and we'll have a live report.
Live from downtown Detroit, Local 4 News First at 4 starts now.
Good afternoon, everybody. I'm Karen Drew. It is hot, it is humid, and the conditions really are perfect for scattered summer thunderstorms. We want to take a look at what's happening right now, so let's bring in Ben Bailey. So how's the weekend going to start, Ben?
For most of us, we're dry right now, Karen, but we are still under that marginal risk for all of southeast Michigan. We were yesterday and nothing happened, but a little bit different today. We've got that humidity that we're dealing with that we didn't have to contend with on Thursday. You can see we haven't seen a lot of thunderstorms, but there's some lightning strikes that have shown up, and just within that last 10 to 15 minutes. Southern portions of Oakland and Macomb County, you're getting some boomers right now. No warnings out, but we're going to be watching these for the potential of a wind gust, some large hail, and definitely some downpours and lightning with these storms. Heat index readings are at 93 right now in Monroe, officially 91 at the airport, but we have seen some spots that have already hit 97 for a heat index this afternoon. It's going to be toasty any way you cut it. Storms should fade after sunset, and we'll talk more about your weekend and 4th of July coming up.
All right, thank you, Ben. Also, first at 4, a terrible crime on Detroit's east side as a father tells police his 12-year-old son was sexually assaulted during a home invasion. Police say three young men burst into a home this morning on Beaconsfield near Outer Drive. We're told the men broke into the house, demanded cash and cell phones, and then, according to the boy's father, his son told him a man pointed a gun and sexually assaulted him.
From what I can tell now, he's really shaken up from the process. Everything, he's holding strong because he wasn't going to let them see him not keep his cool.
Meantime, right now, police are looking for the three men who went into that house as well as a getaway driver. We'll have more on the investigation and from the boy's family tonight at 5. Inside an Ann Arbor courtroom this morning, a man learned he'll spend the rest of his life in prison for the murder of a retired University of Michigan professor. Earlier this month, a jury found Isom Hamilton guilty of the 2018 murder of retired professor Robert Sharp. Emotions ran high in court as Hamilton went off on the judge, calling his trial a sham. He continues to maintain his innocence. Hamilton and his attorney plan an appeal. The Flint water crisis will take center stage once again tonight after all pending criminal cases were dropped earlier this month. Wayne County Prosecutor Kim Worthy and Solicitor General Fadwa Hamoud will be answering the community's questions. The charges were dropped so criminal investigations could have a fresh start with new evidence. The meeting is tonight from 6 to 8 at the UAW Local 659 Hall on Van Slyke Road, and that is in Flint. We will have a crew there tonight and have live coverage starting this evening at 5. Some Michigan Democrats trying to rally support to overturn the Trump administration's travel ban targeting largely Muslim nations. It's been one of the most divisive issues during the Trump presidency. Supporters call it a matter of security. Supreme Court upheld the third version of the ban. Local 4's Paula Tupman takes a look at efforts to overturn it and has one family's personal story.
He's a 6-year-old boy whose name and face cannot be revealed because he is in a country where he would not be safe if others knew he was trying to reunite with his father, who's in the United States.
The younger one is like sick, you know, he's very tidy.
They are 12 and 14-year-old boys whose names and faces cannot be revealed because it could be a threat to their mother and brother who are trying to reunite with them in their own country. Only their father is willing to show his face and tell the story of how his family has been separated for 3 years.
There's a lot of people, it's not only me, there's a lot of people like that. They affect the same thing.
Talal was born in the United States but returned to his ancestral homeland of Yemen to find a wife and start a family. He and two of his children are U.S. citizens. His wife and his youngest son are not. The paperwork and red tape to get them into his homeland was mired in bureaucracy. But he finally won an interview for a travel visa for the rest of his family. But the day before that interview, the Supreme Court upheld the travel ban, often called the Muslim ban. Those who support the ban say it's not about religion. It's about where terrorists originate or are supported or sponsored. Today, three congresspeople met with the community to declare the uphill fight to reverse the Supreme Court decision that upholds that ban.
The Supreme Court upheld one of President Trump's most blatantly discriminatory policies. He put a ban on Muslim people traveling to the United States, something that, just to say it, is almost sacrilegious to our secular values.
They introduced to the community a House bill, the Repeal the Ban Act, which the Michigan Democratic Caucus says begins a harrowing journey through committee.
The Civil Rights Act, pushing for equality in education, all of that took introducing bills.
Change takes time, but if you stay and you're steady, when you know that something's the right thing to do, you don't give up till you get it done. We are fighting for our Constitution. So we won't stop fighting until we get it done.
So the Michigan delegation says it does have bipartisan support to get this bill through. I do need to tell you that I did reach out to all seven members of the Michigan Republican Caucus to get a comment, have not heard back from any of them. Suffice it to say, there is not enough support believed to be in the Senate to pass this bill. But the Michigan delegation says that is not a reason to not try the fight. Karen?
All right. Thank you very much, Paula. The Supreme Court is wading into another heated immigration debate. Today, justices announced they will decide if President Trump can end the Obama-era DACA program for the so-called Dreamers. Now, that protects the 700,000 people brought to the U.S. illegally as children. President Trump ordered an end to the program back in 2017. The case will likely go to court in late fall or early winter with a decision by June 2020. Meantime, the president is sharing the world stage with Russia's Vladimir Putin for the first time since the Mueller report was made public. Once again, the president's interaction with Putin is being questioned, and a Michigan congresswoman is blasting what the world saw overnight. Let's bring in Kimberly Gill. She's in the newsroom with the video from Japan and reaction from home. Kim.
Hi, Karen. Good afternoon. The president has been meeting with many world leaders at the G20 summit in Japan, but the meeting with Vladimir Putin comes after the Mueller report clearly outlined how Russia tried to influence the 2016 presidential election. That led to this exchange today. Well, Vladimir Putin was seen laughing along with the president. These two leaders are closely watched wherever they go and when they get together. Later, President Trump, though, praised Vladimir Putin, saying there's a lot of positive things coming from their meetings. Michigan Congresswoman Debbie Dingell, though, isn't laughing about that meeting.
For him to make a joke of telling Putin not to interfere in our elections is offensive to me, unacceptable, and I think one of the things we have to take most seriously is how do we ensure that no foreign government interferes in our 2020 presidential elections.
Well, the G20 summit is taking place as President Trump faces several international challenges. You've got Iran, you've got North Korea, and a trade war with China. President Trump will hold trade talks with China tomorrow, and that's something else that we'll be watching very closely. Karen, we'll send it back to you until then.
All right, we appreciate it. Thank you, Kim. Sure. Police have arrested a man for murder and kidnapping in the case of a missing University of Utah college student. 23-year-old Mackenzie Lewick disappeared 11 days ago. She was last seen after she took a lift from the airport to a park. Police say she was meeting a 31-year-old Salt Lake City man. Right now, it's not clear if they knew each other previously. Police say they found burned evidence at his home, including the student's remains. Still ahead, we're going to talk about a possible connection between Snapchat, Instagram, and cosmetic procedures. And Dr. George has a holiday warning.
Fireworks caused 9,100 injuries last year, and that reflects what I've seen in the emergency room. In good health, some vivid demonstrations of what happens when things go wrong. See if you've been making some of these dangerous mistakes.
All right, thank you, Doc. Also, have you heard the new Whitney Houston song? It's going viral. It could get you dancing on this Friday afternoon. Stay with us. Trending stories coming your way.